Happy New Year! I'm Pastor Ernie Hinojosa with Rejoice Lutheran Church here in Coppell, Texas. We are delighted that you're here to worship with us today or whenever you happen to be tuning in with us. We do have a few announcements for you. First, I want to remind you that we are in the middle of our giving campaign for 2021. We are so grateful for those of you who have already turned in your commitment card as you've considered and reflected on your giving for this year. We would love to have more than 62 cards. I think 62 was the number we had last year. We are looking to beat that. We're not quite there. So please, you can turn in your commitment card to us. You can send it by mail. You can bring it by when we have an outdoor event. You could also go to our website there at rejoicelutheran.org, and you will see the link kind of in the upper right, and you can turn in your commitment card electronically. Please do attend to that as soon as possible. And thank you again for your commitment to your tithes and offerings here at Rejoice. Our vicar, Cheryl Herodot, has some other announcements for us. Cheryl?
Thank you, Pastor. Happy New Year, 2021. That sounds pretty good, doesn't it? I like the sound of that. Please join us for our next outdoor service. It was so wonderful to see so many of you Christmas week. January 10th, 10 a.m., bring your lawn chair. We love seeing you guys out worshiping in the backyard. If you have a minute to RSVP, we like to know how many to expect. Yes. You can find that in the Joyful Noise. As always, for a complete list of announcements, check out our website at rejoicelutheran.org. And today we will be celebrating virtual communion, so you might take a moment to grab your elements. Your wafer and bread, wine, juice, whatever you have available there, whatever you have is not important. We look forward to breaking bread with you later on in the service this morning.
We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves.
We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name.
Amen.
With joy I proclaim to you that Almighty God, rich in mercy, abundant in love, forgives you all your sin and grants you newness of life in Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, and love, and power, and
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, our nation is in turmoil. There's fear and despair in so many. Give us grace to place our trust in you now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Our first reading is from Psalm 71, verses 1 through 6. In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be to me a rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me. For you are my rock and my fortress. Rescue me, O my God, from the hand of wicked, from the grasp of the unjust and cruel. For you, O Lord, are my hope, my trust, O Lord, from my youth. Upon you I have leaned from birth. It was you who took me from my mother's womb. My praise is continually of you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. This is the Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 6th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Therefore, I tell you, Jesus said, do not worry about your life, what you'll eat or what you'll drink, or about your body, what you'll wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things, and indeed, your heavenly Father knows you need them. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Well, again, it's good to be with you, and Happy New Year, and Merry Christmas, and I'm glad to see you, and glad you're back with us today. First Sunday in the year, it's pretty great. I want to tell you about just something that happened with me not long ago, maybe just earlier in December. I was wanting to do some conversation like I will do from time to time. If there's a kind of a current event topic that I think's interesting and I want to kind of get other people's take on it. And what I'll often do is I'll put a question on my Facebook page and just invite people to reflect or tell me what they're thinking, or I'll say, here's my thinking on this. What do you think? You know, where am I wrong? Where am I not seeing this? And in this particular time, I was putting some links and some threads about our recent presidential election and then those who were contesting the results of the election and just how that whole process went down. And so I offered some questions on that, and it started out pretty good. I mean, it wasn't too uncivil. People were just telling me what they think, and, you know, people don't disagree, but that's fine. But what I found was after a couple of hours and after the comments started kind of accumulating, what I noticed was just the tone, right? The tone of that conversation started to change, and it got more confrontational, and it seemed like the anxiety levels started going up to the point where it almost started getting personal, you know? And interestingly, because I'm participating in this threat, of course, they're my threats. So, I mean, I'm noticing myself, like I'm kind of getting energy behind this topic, and not necessarily the good kind of energy, but it's like I was getting annoyed and then almost angry and like, why don't these people understand? And I had to take those threads down, in fact, because I thought, you know, this is not the kind of conversation I want to have. And some of you are thinking, well, duh, Ernie, like, why would you want to do that on social media if you wanted it to be civil? Like, how many civil conversations about contentious issues are there on platforms like Facebook? I know. It's not the first time I've done that, but I want to say I've had better luck with that. And this last time was just not great. And then I noticed I was chatting with my dad. That's not a picture of me and my dad, of course, but it's just two people arguing. But, you know, my dad's got some strong opinions, and I've got some strong opinions. And in a lot of ways, we see eye to eye. In some ways, we don't. And so we were talking again about this kind of political situation and how it went down, and talking or texting back and forth. And again, it's like I saw this edge start to emerge. You know what I'm talking about? Like where you can kind of tell when a conversation is starting to go down a path you don't want it to go. And I love my dad. My dad loves me. And we talk about stuff and engage in conversations. And we don't always agree on stuff. And it's fine. But for whatever reason, most recently, it just seemed like there just wasn't a way to enter into that space without it getting adversarial. Like, you know, almost, I don't know, just had a feel of it. If you've ever had those kind of conversations on social media, then you know what I'm talking about. And it just struck me that this is kind of almost a microcosm of like our culture as a whole. And I find when I'm in those conversations, I mean, I'm not proud of this, but I find oftentimes it's like I feel like I want to be right. Like my viewpoint is the right viewpoint. And so I'm going back and forth with somebody, or even going back and forth with my dad. And like, it's like I got to win this fight, which is ridiculous. I don't have to win anything. But there's just this edge that gets there, and it starts to cut, right? It starts to become something I don't want it to be. So anyway, I wonder if you've been in a conversation like that recently. I mean, whether you were with family over Thanksgiving and Christmas and New Year, or even if you just talked to them or Zoom with them, if you had some of these conversations about sensitive topics, especially like political topics, I wonder if you had any of those. I wonder if any of those maybe got a little edgy. Something I wanted to highlight for me and for you today. Key number one, I can be right and still be wrong. It's like what starts out as just a conversation about facts, as we see them, it's like an edge starts to creep in, and now it's like anger starts to enter into that equation. And I notice that it doesn't just happen with friends or family. I don't know if you've had that happen with your friends and family, but in churches, you know, churches are very divided on some of these questions, and certainly our culture as a whole, our nation, seems to be very divided. I want to suggest to you that this edge that seems to appear more and more in these conversations is not an accident. It's not necessarily just you or the person you're talking to or the person you're texting or the person with you on social media. But I honestly, honestly believe this. So don't miss this part. It's not an accident that a keen source of conflict and anxiety and even anger and in a few cases even violence in our culture right now is politics. It's always been true. You've heard it said for many years. I was corrected, three things that you're not supposed to talk about in polite company, not supposed to talk about money, not supposed to talk about religion or politics. But it just seems politics in particular is a channel where so much vitriol and anger and division comes about. In fact, I would submit to you, it's not just a natural phenomenon, it's a supernatural phenomenon. Folks, I'm telling you right now, the forces of evil in the heavenly realm, the demonic forces that seek to divide you and your loved ones and your family and your community and your church and your nation, that there is a particular focus right now in the area of political discourse. It is a strategy of the enemy to separate you from those you care about and those you love, and the instrument is political discourse. It divides. It separates. It's like these walls go up sometimes. I was talking to some friends recently telling me they literally have relatives who will not talk to them right now because they didn't vote the correct way, whatever way that was. And even someone whose relatives are literally moving out of town because they just can't stand to be in a place where the votes went in the wrong direction in this person's opinion. There's so little tolerance in political discourse. And friends, it's not an accident. It is a weapon of the enemy to divide the people of God. And you see that kind of thing because unity is such an important thing to the Lord. It's such an important thing. In the New Testament in particular, we see Paul write in Ephesians, he says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Why is Paul encouraging the church to make unity an important part, right, through the bond of peace, to make every effort? Why do you think he's saying that? Because unity maybe is a really hard thing? Because maybe people have a propensity to divide? I think so. I think this was a problem from the word go in the church, which is why Paul's talking about it. Make every effort to keep unity. Or in 1 Corinthians, also the Apostle Paul, I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same purpose. Again, now this is in Ephesus, this is Corinth. Different church, different city, guess what? Same problem. What's the problem? People are having a hard time staying united and in agreement. Or another town, Colossia, another church, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everyone together in perfect unity. I'm going to make a confession. When I'm engaging in these conversations, and whether it's online or social media or in person or on the phone or whatever, I'm afraid things like kindness and compassion and humility, they're a little hard to find. There's something stirs in the people. Why do you think the devil comes after unity so hard? Why do you think there's so much effort in creating walls and divisions between God's people. I want to submit to you folks that when we are united, we are strong. When we are united, 1 + 1 doesn't make 2. It's like 1 + 2, 1 + 1 makes like 4 or 5. It's like the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. Hence the strategy of the enemy to divide us, and particularly to use political discourse. And what gets me, like, I can understand why people who aren't believers would get so energized and excited. Like, I understand why people who are not Christians would receive and adopt this idea that our hope and our future is dependent on who gets elected or who doesn't get elected, or how the outcome of these elections goes. Like, why do you think people fight so hard for this? Because they think that this is where our hope lies, that we stand or fall based on who's elected or who's not elected. It's like somehow we have been convinced that our hope, that our trust, that our future depends on political outcomes, for God's sake. Friends, is Joe Biden your heavenly Father who provides for you? Were you baptized into salvation in the name of Donald Trump? Is the Supreme Court the provider for your every need for you and your family? What's the answer? No, of course not. Of course not. But I'm not going to lie. And I'm telling you, I see this in me sometimes. Sometimes I act as if that is so, as if I am so dependent on these people or these processes or these institutions or, God forbid, the media. I think everybody's in agreement that the media is demonic. Pretty sure we all agree that's kind of true. We get so energized, like it's such a heinous crime. And I think we act as if we have no God. We act as if we have no hope apart from what's in this world. How in the world can that happen, church? How can Christians act in this way? How can we get on board? Again, I get how secular people might buy it because they have nothing else to turn to. But that's not true for you and me. We know better. Our hope is in the Lord. Do you know what the Bible calls when we trust in, place our hope in something other than God? It's called idolatry. Here's number 2. Idolatry is when we place our trust in something or someone other than God. You read about this all over the scripture, especially in the New Testament. Even God's people, you'll see them. They build altars. They build Asherah poles. They build temples to a god called Baal. They make statues of wood and stone and precious metals. And people literally, like, worship them, pray to them, make offerings to them. God's not cool with that. God gets on the people because of idolatry. Now, the trick for you and me is when I read about that in the Bible, I think, well, man, you know, I screw up a lot, but that's not one of them. Like, I don't have a statue in my house that I bow down to and light candles to and worship to or something like that. But here's the deal, folks. No, we probably don't have a statue at home on an altar that we worship, but I'm telling you right now, a lot of us are placing our trust and hope in something that is not God. And I am sad to say, I am also guilty of it from time to time. It's the way our world teaches us. It's called idolatry. Psalm 71 says this: "You, O Lord, are my hope, my trust, O Lord, from my youth. Upon you I have leaned from my birth. It was you who took me from my mother's womb. My praise is continually of you. In whom is your hope brother? In whom is your hope, sister? Let me just say, and even maybe to remind you, just as I had to remind myself recently, our hope is in nothing of this world. My hope and your hope is in the Lord Jesus. The Lord Jesus crucified and risen. The Lord Jesus who gave his life for you and me, that we might have eternal life now and in the life to come. It is our Heavenly Father that conceived you in the womb, who called you by name, who when he created you, has a plan and purpose for you from the word go. It's true. Our Heavenly Father who provides for our every need. It's not the government, it's not the courts, and it's darn sure not the media. It's the Lord. Don't forget that. Don't buy the lies of the world around you. Stand in the truth of the Lord. Let's pray. Lord, it's easy to get confused. And some of us like to do these conversations just for fun. It's kind of like sport, you know? I don't play full court basketball anymore, so, you know, I have these conversations, and I see if I can win. And I think it's going to be fun, but then it's not. Then something happens, Lord. And I know, Lord, that it's a strategy of the enemy right now to divide people, to divide a nation, to divide a family, to divide a city, to divide a couple, to separate people from one another who love one another. Lord, we pray, bring your peace. Reveal to us the truth of who you are and whose we are. And thank you in advance, Lord, for your care and love for us. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us profess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Joining our voices with the song of the angels, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those who are in need. Redeeming God, you gather together your people from the farthest parts of the earth. Protect your church from stumbling. Let it not be overcome by sorrow, division, or despair. Make us radiant with goodness, that we might live always to the praise of your glory. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You overflow with grace upon grace. Expand the imaginations of those who serve in positions of authority. Open their hearts to the needs of their nations and communities. Protect all those in harm's way and those risking danger for the sake of others. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You bring consolation to those who weep. Embrace those who feel far off, excluded, or defeated. Accompany those living with chronic and invisible illness. Sustain the weak and weary. Refresh those who labor under the weight of pain or sickness, especially the Birch family, Kendra, Mackenzie, and Lisa, the Schmidt and Swanson families, the Gonzalez and Ratcliffe families, John, Lindsay, Morgan, Patty, Shirley, and Lisa, the Parrish and Cadigan families, the Stutzman and Mudrick families, Davian, Katie, and the Zastro family. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. God of mercy, come quickly to us with grace upon grace as we lift these and all our prayers to you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share a word of peace with those in your midst. Also, we would love for you to post your peace in the comments and let us know where you're watching from. We always appreciate that.
Peace.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
At Rejoice, we always appreciate your commitment to your tithes and offerings. There are several ways to give at Rejoice Lutheran Church. You can check out our website at rejoicelutheran.org. The top center, there's a button that says tithes and offering. You can find us on Venmo. Our handle is at Rejoice Lutheran, and you can always drop a check in the mail. Please know how much you're appreciated and how much great work is being done because of your commitment to your tithes and offerings at Rejoice. Let us pray together. Good and loving God, we rejoice in the birth of Jesus, who came among the poor to bring the riches of your grace. As you have blessed us with your gifts, let them be blessings for others. With the trees of the field, with all earth and heaven, we shout for joy at the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
with you.
And also with you.
We lift up your hearts.
We lift them up, Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God our thanks and praise.
It is our duty and delight that we should everywhere and always offer thanks and praise to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, who is your word made flesh among us. And so with the church on earth, all creation, and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. If you happen to be by yourself and are ready to take communion, please let me be your communion assistant. So you can take your bread or your cracker, whatever you may have, and receive that. The body of Christ given for you. And again, the wine or juice, whatever you may have, the blood of Christ shed for you. And now, others of you who are communing with others in your midst, please feel free to share communion at this time.
Today, O Lamb of God, you take away the
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Amen. Radiant God, with our eyes we have seen your salvation, and in this meal we have feasted on your grace. May your word take flesh in us, that we may be your holy people, revealing your glory made known to us in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen.
The Lord bless and keep you, shine his face upon you, the Lord grant you grace and give your family peace. With Christmas glee may you rejoice abundantly. The Father's grace surrounding, the Savior's love abounding, the Spirit's power resounding
Rejoicing and growing God's kingdom.
May we love God, love each other, and love the world.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And we will. See you next year, everyone.